Trinidad and Tobago, welcome to an edition of Scoreboard here on ACTN Television. It's always a pleasure every Tuesday evening to come into your homes where we talk something dealing with sports, especially in Trinidad and Tobago. Before I introduce my guests for tonight's show, I just want to say condolences to the family and the friends of the Trinidad and Tobago Football Rugby Union on the passing of their vice president, Mr. Carl Seymour. Hopefully things are in place that my next episode next week, I'll be doing a full 60 minutes of tribute to Mr. Seymour. So hopefully the people who are responsible for that put things in place and we have that show for you next week. But again, condolences to his family. My guest for tonight, I really appreciate him coming all the way down from Port of Spain. Dapper looking. You know, he's always somebody that I the few times I sit and chat with him, you know, you get that positiveness coming out of him. So let me introduce the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee President, Mr. Brian Lewis. Brian, it's a pleasure and welcome to South once again.
Well, it's always a pleasure to be here on your program and greetings to your viewers.
Yeah.
I just don't like the idea that you're making it sound as if Port of Spain so far, and I'm one of those Port of Spain people who doesn't.
No, I know.
I don't want to give them any wrong.
All right. On television, my apologies, Mr. Lewis. Talking about rugby, you knew this guy, the vice president?
Man,
what? Well, I know you into rugby.
Yeah, remember, prior to being on the Olympic Committee.
Mm.
I mean, let me put it this way. When I got onto the Olympic Committee, I was the then secretary of the Trinidad and Tobago Rugby Football Union. And I came over because I went to an Olympic Committee council meeting to represent the rugby union. At the time, the representative, Anthony Loringnad, couldn't go for some particular reason. Mm. So I went and that's how one thing led to another.
Mm.
So yeah, I know Carl.
Any fond memories
of Carl?
Yeah.
So I have to tell you, and your viewers and those who are into rugby will know, because there's at a point in time, Royal Lions was one of the top clubs.
Mm-hmm.
The club I would have played for was a small fry in the rugby.
Yeah, and he is the one who really
merged with Gavaras and became GF, GF United. And then in 1998, we went into Harvard as the rugby section in Harvard Club. But so we would have had a very keen rivalry with Royal Lions, Caribs, Trinidad, Nazans in particular. But the thing about Carl is he's one of these individuals who is almost counterintuitive, meaning you know Carl's personality and his demeanor. And you know, you kind of Carl plays rugby. Carl is a very committed, dedicated, hard-hitting rugby. Because anybody who plays rugby could be considered an enigma. Because when you get on that rugby field, they calm. Because it's about contact. Rugby is a contact sport. So you can't be shy about contact and play rugby.
Mm.
So that's the thing about Carl. So he was always this, came across as this always very cerebral individual, you know, deep thinker, you know, not we'd associate with the rambunctiousness, so to speak, of rugby and the whole rugby culture, you know, after the game, the singing of rugby songs and you know. I mean, at what point in time, it's no secret rugby had a beer drinking culture. You must have
I think they still have a little thing attached to it. I think it's still a little thing attached to
No, of course, because it is at the recreational level, a social, it's a game. Because at the end of it, it's a hard fought, hard hitting game.
That's why we want all the come down point.
Huh?
That's why we want all the come down point. Rugby must come down point.
Rugby?
Yeah.
Well, my days, thankfully, my days in the rugby field. I'll come and watch gladly.
Yeah. Well,
so let me extend my condolences to Carl's family and his club, Royal Lions, the Trinidad and Tobago Rugby Football Union, and the rugby fraternity. I know that within recent times, his, because of his profession, mm-hmm. his strategic approach and experience would have been a key part of the current president's calling, Colin Peters. So he would have formed a critical mm-hmm. and important mm-hmm. part of Colin's team. So I know mm-hmm. that in that context, it's going to be a big blow mm-hmm. for the Colin Peters administration.
Mm. Anyway, as you said, condolences to his friends, his family. But tonight I want to talk to you based on what has been the response or what has the TTOC been doing behind the scenes during the COVID-19 pandemic. Mm-hmm. I know that there were a lot of Zoom projects that you all implemented. And besides that, I know you had your AGM and, you know, there are little things we want to talk about. So let's talk about...
We have
about,
enough time?
Yeah, we have enough time. We'll talk in bullet form. What has been the TTOC up to during this couple, 8-9 months doing behind the scenes?
Well, let me sort of frame it by simply saying that to begin with, COVID-19 has been tremendously disruptive.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not only unique to Trinidad and Tobago. It's globally. Credit and thanks to the frontline workers who all those who would have contributed to keep things ticking over and expose themselves in service of their fellow citizens in the case of Trinidad and Tobago. But sport in particular has been literally devastated. Sport has shut down globally. It's now getting back up. But even here in Trinidad and Tobago, you know, the government and the public health authorities and the Ministry of Health, they're slowly relaxing certain things. But it has been incredibly disruptive to the point where, you know, I've said this. I think that there are a number of sporting organizations that will not survive the COVID. So the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee, as the lead organization for Olympic sports mm. and considered at the top of the pyramid, we have had to be innovative and creative. We have had to lead by example. Not everything we would have done, or not everything I may have articulated and done as the president, everyone will agree with. But we would have had to make decision, and I would have had to make decision with an understanding of the big picture, mm. seeing down the horizon what's before us. Mm-hmm. So that one of the things I'm incredibly proud about from the organization and the entire team at Olympic House is that the TTOC has pioneered mm-hmm. the virtual and digital leap of faith. We have not lamented. We have gone full-fledged we have run a number of virtual events. Mm-hmm. We are extremely active. I mean, credit to the executive, Secretary General.
How was the response?
Fantastic.
Okay.
Fantastic. You know, I'm really appreciative of the support that we would have gotten. Lovey Santana, the senior admin officer, Stacey Santana, Risa Grant, Lauren Legal.
Mm-hmm. And we have a powerful team.
Yes, yeah. And women in terms of future female.
Much credit doesn't hear much people talking about it, but...
No, but you know? Of course, it's a natural human thing to focus on what's wrong and all the negatives rather than what's right. So what we have done is attempted to lead from in the front in terms of virtual. We have organized a number of sports administration courses focused with COVID-19. How do you pivot from the Olympic Committee side, the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee. We are also the Trinidad and Tobago Commonwealth Games Association. Mm-hmm. So that in that context, the Commonwealth Youth Games 2021 has been impacted. In terms of our committed, dedicated patriots that make up the athletes who represent mm-hmm. Team TTO, of course, with the Olympic Games being rescheduled, the uncertainty it has been tremendously challenging and real problematic in terms of financially and economically, so that there are a host of problems, obstacles, that we have had to look for the opportunities in the chaos, so to speak.
Now, a lot of the tournaments were canceled, the Olympics. I noticed this week that the NGA's president was hinted that there might not be curfew for 2021, right? Hopefully, the Olympics will be in 2021.
Mm-hmm.
From your standpoint, how is the committee and the athletes working together? Because I am sure that some of the athletes have been going through pressure, maybe financial or whatever it is. Is there some sort of arrangement where, or support coming from the Olympic Committee to the athletes?
Well, the Olympic Committee, we would have put in place since 2013 when I became the privilege and honor to be elected the president of the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee. We had established a position, project officer, athlete welfare and services, and that person's focus is entirely on athletes. The fact is that the person who holds that position is a national athlete herself, Rita Grant.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We have created the conduit for ongoing contact with the athletes, so that has worked very well in these circumstances. Of course, because of the myriad of challenges, we may not always be able to meet the expectations of all the athletes all the time, especially with the financial aspect of it, because the TTOC them ourselves, we have to operate within our means. No, we don't get a government subvention.
Okay.
And most people misunderstand that, as they do the fact that they believe, for example, the president of the TTOC and the executive are highly paid. We are not. We are unpaid volunteers.
Okay.
So that we have put in place certain measures. We do continuously help the athletes as best as we could. We have had workshops or webinars where mental health has been a focus.
Mm-hmm.
And we have had Dr. Safiza Mohammed, who is tremendous. She's really tremendous in terms of how she delivers and her focus on mental health and resilience.
Mm.
So, short answer to your question is that we are doing the best within the available means and resources we have. If we could do more, absolutely. If I'd love to do more, absolutely. A lot of our fundraising have been impacted negatively.
All through the world, most organizations, if not all, has been, you know, severely hampered by the COVID-19 restrictions and things like that. You all held AGM recently, and I noticed that a lot of things, not a lot, but a couple of things have changed. Now, I don't know if those things will change with the eyeing of the Olympics in 2021, or if they were on the drawing board for a period of time. If you want to share that with us.
A couple of them would have been, for example, in terms of the transformation of our marketing strategy, where we would have disbanded the marketing subcommittee, created a working group, and what we have done is, everyone will hear much more about it in the coming months and weeks, but we also got approval for that direction from the AGM under the annual report, and that is the formation of Team TTO Marketing Limited, Team TTO TV, and Team TTO Media. So that was on the drawing board.
Mm-hmm.
What wasn't was the amendment that we had to do to facilitate, under the Constitution, virtual meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So that was really and purely as a result and a consequence of the impact of COVID. So although the Olympic Committee we did have digital transformation, as a key strategic pillar. It was more incremental and transactional than revolutionary and radical. COVID became an accelerator. So we had to do that. So we amended the constitution, which permitted virtual meeting. So all systems go now going forward in terms of that virtual aspect. We also would have made an amendment as it relates to the mediation and arbitration procedure, which was done because increasingly the Olympic Committee have been called upon to mediate and arbitrate with conflicts and disputes. So we needed to bring clarity to that process. So that was done.
Now, if we go back to the whole COVID situation, are you all already planning, or the plans are in place, hoping that the Olympics be held next year?
But you took your 20th
yeah, right? Like, you can hold your thoughts, we're going to take a break, but when you come back, I want you to touch on that a bit.
Sure, not a problem.
Right. Viewers, you are viewing Scoreboard here on ACT, and we'll be right back after the short break. Welcome to another edition of Scoreboard here on ACT, and it's always a pleasure to be in your company every Tuesday evening between the hours of 8 and 9. Welcome back, viewers. Welcome back to Scoreboard on ACT. And right before the break, how are plans in place, and if you can reveal, what are some of the plans that you all have already put in place for Tokyo? Well, yeah, let's say 2020, but it's going to be held in 2021.
Right.
Because so far, it appears that it's on. So I guess the athletes, well, who training, but you all have to start to put things in place. Well, I guess you all had already had things in place, but it didn't fall, it fall apart because of COVID. What are the new plans that you have in place for?
Right. So the process and with the International Olympic Committee and its president, Thomas Bach, should be told is that we never stopped planning and doing as if the Olympics, in other words, we continue to operate as if the Olympics was on.
Okay.
Because all the signals behind the scenes was that the Olympics would be on COVID or no COVID. Because there is a reality, and that is that the financially, the Olympic movement and the IOC could not and cannot afford for there to be no Olympic Games Tokyo 2020, which is now in 2021, because the IOC, International Olympic Committee, generates most of its funding from the broadcast rights. So if that Tokyo 2020 don't happen, it's going to be a very deep rabbit hole for the Olympic movement until 2024 in Paris, when the next time the broadcast rights would be due. So it's not a reckless disregard of the safety and health issues. It is a pragmatic realism that the International Olympic Committee, working with Tokyo 2020 and the World Health Organization and public health experts, had to plan and do as if this Olympic Games will happen. So we, having properly assessed, let me put it this way, the operating environment, we continued planning. Now, the real issue and challenge would have been the funding side. So with the Olympic qualifiers shut down, track and field is our major, in my view, I've always maintained track and field is the number one Olympic sport.
Yeah.
15 out of our 19 medals. So that with the Diamond Leagues, etc., shut down, it meant that our professional track and field athletes struggle financially. Also, most of the contracts that they would sign are performance-based. So you don't run, you have no bonuses to get, so it's been problematic. So in that regard, that is where our most significant challenge would have been. Added to that, the commercial space we operate in is challenged. Mm-hmm. Tokyo, usually the year of the Olympics is when, well, I know for sure the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee, it is our most positive and successful revenue generation period. Our commemorative magazine, sponsors, etc. So we have lost that. That has been like a between 6 to 9 million TT hit. Then additional to that, the contracts that you would have had that would have run to December 2020, which is in the year of the Olympics, the event didn't happen. So now legally you have to give an extension to when, because the contracts were based on the Olympics. So now you have to give that extension to the Olympics and the consideration. There is no consideration because the consideration would have been used up during the 4 years. So that has created some challenges. In addition, the cost. So in terms of our budget and preparation, cost, vaccine, COVID-19, quarantine, it's been. So that's where the real problem has been. How do we out all of these fires in an environment and a scenario and atmosphere where the only thing that was certain, that is certain with COVID-19, is the uncertainty?
Well, most likely the Olympics will happen because when you look at cricket and NBA and all these large sports,
huge money.
Yeah, but you know. do you see the Olympics happening in 2021?
Yes, I've never doubted that it would happen, as I'm saying. I know that.
But minus spectators, I guess.
Well, I noted recently the International Olympic Committee president is saying that they seem to want spectators. But for me, it's about the athletes. Athletes have sacrificed 8 and 15 and all their life for this. I see other sports successfully having biosecure bubble. So I don't see why we should be exposing the additional risk to wanting to have all these spectators. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, for the IOC and the big commercial broadcast people, I guess it's about the optics. Mm-hmm. But for the athletes, they just want safely and healthy to go to the Olympics, perform as best as they could, given the break from their training.
I was going to ask you that. Do you see some of the athletes not performing at their best because of the cancellation?
Yes, certainly. But, you know, it's an interesting thing. Quietly, I always felt that, for sure, Team TTO, the Trinidad and Tobago team, that the opportunity to perform well in this circumstance is in our favor. Now, I say that some people say it's a little tongue-in-cheek because once you have a level playing field, drugs and financial doping and technical doping is out of it, our athletes, we would have won a lot more medals. I know people want to criticize me and say that. It is what it is, I agree, you compete as it, but the fact remains that, in general, our athletes compete clean. Mm-hmm. So, once the playing field is level, they have a good chance as any. And I'm cautiously optimistic that if the Olympics, or when the Olympics is held next year, that the country will have some fun. I genuinely believe that. Of course, I could end up with egg on my face, but I'm not afraid of that.
I'm not bashing anybody, but I have yet to hear from the city, the government, on a policy to deal with sports during the COVID pandemic. I saw you wrote an article recently where you were referring to the organizations to be mindful with the reopening of, you know.
It was an interview. Yeah.
Right. But do you see chaos down the road if sports is open up now without a proper guidance or policy in what to do, especially like sports in different areas, maybe the rural areas and things like that? Do you find it necessary that something should come out to kind of like put people on a certain direction as how to handle different sports if and when it opens?
Certainly. But I think that the onus is on the sporting organization.
Okay.
And I put my hand up and say that I think the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee, we would have dropped the ball on that, notwithstanding the fact that our medical team led by Dr. Ali, for the last 3 months, it includes Dr. Rudy Ramsawak and Dr. Nyla Adams, have been looking at COVID-19 return to sport guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
I think that if I have to be perfectly honest, I think we have been a little bit too cautious. And in that regard, I think we have dropped the ball. Somebody within sport, mm-hmm. not the government, because mm-hmm. they are focused on, they have the Ministry of Health that has given them a framework. There's mm-hmm. World Health Authority guideline, but I think that we dropped the ball in terms of that. So I think that the responsibility is sport organization, because in the case of the TTOC, we have the IOC, and they're devoting a lot of energy and time. I saw a couple of days ago that the president of the IOC made a statement that if necessary, they will fund vaccines.
Mm.
That's extraordinary for me, because I would hate to see sport get an up. As much as we won the Olympics, there were other people inside of it that I would think would be prioritized.
Mm-hmm.
But whether it's the FIFA, the footballs, all the different organizations, I think that, to be fair, track and field in AAAs, mm-hmm. they would have done something, because I actually saw mm-hmm. that they had released a document. So, in answer to your question, I think that the responsibility would have been and should be on the sporting organization themselves, including the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee.
So you would agree with the opening up last week of all national teams, because as I was telling somebody, to open sports generally to everybody, I mean, that is where the chaos will start, because the little five-a-side football tournament down in Moruga, there are no guidelines, people come out. So do you agree with this national teams and national athletes because of the eyes on the Olympics, right?
Well, I'm biased and could be accused quite rightly of being biased.
Mm-hmm.
But we have the Olympics coming up, and we needed to get Olympic athletes training. I know that the football team and the cricket team and the volleyball team, they have tournaments coming up, hopefully in the first quarter of 2021,
mm-hmm.
subject again to COVID-19. So that it a catch-22 situation. I could well understand why there may be the view that it is easier to control and manage those risks. But I could also understand the frustration of all the other
mm-hmm.
Sports and athletes, because at the end of the day, physical activity and strengthening your immune system is also one of the key ways to protect, to mitigate against the infection rate. So, like everything else, decision with the economy open, to open, difficult choices have had to be made. And that's why my response to it is that sports must accept the responsibility, because it is very easy for sport, all of those activities that are being allowed, for it to become a super spreader. It's just, COVID-19 is unforgiving. One error, one little oversight, and that's it. It spreads. So it's really not an easy situation, but at the end of the day, you know, we do have the Olympics coming up, and we do have to have the team TTO, Team Trinidad and Tobago athletes that are home based.
Mm.
And those who are outside and want to come back, mm-hmm. they have to be able to train.
Normally, they have the senior champs where they select you by your time to make the team for the Olympics. How do you see that playing out? Because that has to be done before to pick a national team.
All right. So I know that Ephraim Saret, who is the president of the NAAA, he's also a vice president of the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee. I know that is a key part of their deliberation, because mm-hmm. it forms a key part, as you quite rightly say, of the Olympic selection for the track and field team, which will make up the majority of Team TTO. It is usually, it's in June. So that's like second quarter 2021. Maybe we'll continue to get good news in terms of the vaccine and other measures, and they'll be able to have it.
Mm. Do you see us in the years to come less viewing sports on television with no spectators for a while?
You know, that's not sport. Sport is driven by the atmosphere. Sport is driven by the, what they call, you know, the spectator. But it is a reality that requires a number of sports to pivot. It's a new normal. I don't think it's realistic to expect, even with a vaccine, if you can appreciate how this vaccine has to work its way through to all of us. I think that we will have COVID-19 and these challenges at least still in 2023. So let me put it this way. I think that sports that don't necessarily need fans and audience to develop that oomph, they are the sports that will have an opportunity. For example, esports. I think esports is going to become huge.
Mm-hmm.
Because also of its youth dynamics. You know, virtual versions of the sports, I think it's going to become a significant factor. Sports that aren't team sports will have an opportunity. So it is really about the sporting organization showing some type of leadership. I find that a lot of sport, I'm focusing on sport.
Mm-hmm.
Sport leaders appear to be overwhelmed, understandably so. But at the end of the day, leaders have to quickly rise to the occasion when things, you know, when they mess with the fan, and figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things I would like our sporting organizations to do, instead of pulling my head and crying, you know what I mean, and bawling, and the sky is falling. So if the sky is falling, what are you going to do?
That's where good governance will come in.
Huh?
That's where good governance will come in.
That's where good governance comes.
And you have been dealing with good governance recently.
Yeah, well, what would have happened, actually, this good commitment to good governance,
mm-hmm.
it goes back to 2015 when we went on we had a workshop, we brought in a good governance expert, Dr. Mm-hmm. Lee Robinson. It was a collaborative effort between the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee and the Olympic Solidarity. And we had a whole set of surveys and workshops and everything. And coming out of that, there was a good governance commitment. And then it was taken in the 2016 AGM and put into the constitution as a commitment. And what ought to have happened was that it was an annual report that was supposed to be generated. So the one we had this year was the first one done. Mm. And it really holds up a mirror image as to, based on the commitment, how do you measure compared to that? Mm. I can include things like term limitation, constitutional reform and review. So it forms an important part of the whole thing, because in the absence of good governance, it's very difficult to be transparent, accountable, to react to changes and in the operating environment. So good governance is important. So we had this. Next year we'll do another one. The results of the survey, so to speak, has been very disappointing. Mm-hmm. Of the 42 affiliates of the Olympic Committee, half completed the survey. And then in some instances, you had 18 meeting a thing and five. So when you take that in terms of the whole, 5 out of 42, 18 out of 42, it highlights why we have a number of issues, bacchanal and, mm-hmm. and all of the mm-hmm. things. And the athletes, the public and the media are quite right to feel that sporting administrators, we in it for the wrong reasons, we don't do a good job, because the survey showed that there were significant governance commitment gaps. So instead of people getting triggered and defensive, I think we need to face it head on mm-hmm. and correct it.
We need to take another break. When I come back, I want to chat with you a bit about the job itself, you know, and what are some of your plans, you know, going forward for the Olympic Committee. I know you're grooming a lot of young people. I know you're heavily involved in that. But I want to find out, you know, what has kept you going for, you know, in spite of all the critics and the bad mouthers, you know, and what plans you have. Or when your term is up, how would you like to leave the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee?
Sure.
Because we'll be right back after the short break. Good evening, Trinidad and Tobago. Welcome to another edition of Scoreboard here on ACT, and it's always a pleasure to be in your company every Tuesday evening between the hours of 8 and 9. Welcome back, viewers. Welcome back to Scoreboard ACT. And if you miss any part of this program, remember there's a repeat tomorrow at 1 p.m. and also 2 p.m. on Saturday afternoon. Brian, once you're in a hot seat, you know, there are people who for you, against you, who can't make up their mind. You understand? How has your term as leader, president, how has that been for you? You're easy, rocky, you know, or you don't take on people?
Like everything else, it has its good moments and its tough moments. I mean, there were things that, in hindsight, I could have done better. Mm. There are mistakes you make, but it is about evolving and learning and keep moving forward. Leadership is not a popularity contest. And anything you're leading in Trinidad and Tobago is not an easy, thing. Mm-hmm. But I thrive on challenges. I thrive on the bigger picture. And for me, the bigger picture is the power of sport to make a positive difference in the lives of youth and young people. My effort at gender equality and trying to champion and advocate for greater involvement of female and women in sports at all levels, mm-hmm. including the leadership, the transformation of the marketing approach, the introduction of sport industry, TT, mm-hmm. The marathon walk mm-hmm. and those types of things. So there are things that you look back and you feel that you have given it a good shot. So for me, at the end of the day, I mean, I'm looking forward to, when I'm no longer the president of the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee, and for all those who believe that it's otherwise, that is going to be after the Olympic Games under the Constitution. So that's just around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, if the Olympics had been held this year,
mm-hmm.
that would be it. My two terms, April 2021.
Mm-hmm.
Now that the Olympics is in 2021, of course, that was acknowledged too at the AGM. I mean, actually, people may not believe this, but I had to be persuaded by my colleagues to continue on. If you gave me the chance, I would have exercised the right to have gone by April 2020.
Is it because you have done all that you could, or because of?
No, not really. I believe that in terms of leadership, there needs to be refresh and renewal.
Okay.
People need to hear a different voice after a while. They get fed up of you. But when I came in and was elected, there were many naysayers. I'm comfortable with that. But I knew that it would have been two terms at maximum.
Mm-hmm.
So it because it requires a lot of focus away from my businesses, focus away from family, focus away from friends. So I knew I would give it everything I had and then move on. Mm-hmm. I'm not one of those who mm-hmm. want to be in a wheelchair. Mm-hmm. You know, I have a lot of sports administrators. They hold on. That wasn't my thing. But one of the big goals I would have set was that I wanted to me, the litmus test of whether I have done a good job as a leader is how many leaders we have created. So I focused a lot on building capacity, female, empowering the athletes.
Mm-hmm.
That to me is the most important thing, because I hate this conversation people have. Well, boy, I'm no longer the president or no longer on the board, and you see all the catch mm-hmm. in the tail. That's not me. You know, I remember my first staff meeting. I told them, when I demit office, whether it would have been the 4 years or the 8 years,
mm-hmm.
the test for me of whether I've done an effective job is that they mustn't call me back for anything. They mustn't mm-hmm. need me. You know, they could run things on their own. And, you know, so for me, I've enjoyed the opportunity. The good and the bad. I mean, coming from Bedford Lane in Belmont, single parent, you know, it being always passionate about sport, the opportunity to serve my country at a different level. I mean, I always wanted to be an Olympian. I didn't get that opportunity because I wasn't good enough, no problem. So the opportunity, some may feel I wasn't good enough, I'm still not good enough,
mm-hmm.
but that's all right. One thing I am comfortable with, I can look myself in the mirror and say that I gave it my all and my
mm-hmm.
best.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say is your greatest, you know, accomplishment, something that you will, at the end of the day, will walk away knowing that, yes, I made a difference, you know, in X, Y, or Z, you know?
If I had to pick two areas, it would be the gender equity and creating an environment that creates a safe space for women and females to become president. I'm very open. The next president of the Olympic Committee, subject to democracy, should be a female. The Olympic Committee was established in 1946.
Mm-hmm.
It's never had a female at president. Something has to be wrong with that. The other thing would be the marketing transformation in terms of, so one of the things the annual general meeting approved was the transition of the 10 goal by 2024 athlete welfare and preparation fund mm. to a foundation. I think that is something that I because I believe the sustainable opportunity to support the athletes in a foundation, distinct from any other foundation. There are a number of foundations out there that focus on many different worthwhile things, mm-hmm. but none that focuses purely on supporting the athletes in a sustainable way. So whether it is fundraising with the merchandising, the fundraising for the marathon walk, mm-hmm. Corporate Trinidad and Tobago, which has supported the athletes' welfare fund, hopefully they'll support the foundation. That is targeted to be established legally and set up by December 2020. I think that is something that will derive and augurs well for supporting the athletes in a more sustainable way. That would be one of the thing.
I noticed that the group you have working with you took them at a very kind of young age, and they have grown with you, and it's a full female thing. Are you grooming them to be able to run with the TTOC after you?
Well, so, for example, people like Lovie Santana and City mm-hmm. Santana, they were there.
Mm, right.
What may have happened in the last, since 2013, is that they may have got more opportunity. For right. example, Lovie Santana, I mean, I'm incredibly proud of how she has grown. In fact, she's going to be the chef de mission at the Tokyo 2020 Games. I mean, that's almost unprecedented. When usually most NOCs pivot towards members of the executive to hold that prestigious position. So we brought in the marketing. We established a marketing department, athlete welfare services. So those people would have come in. So that the answer to your question, yes, I always believed it was important for the TTOC to have sustainability and capacity and competence in terms of its day-to-day management.
Mm-hmm.
You know, rather than every time an executive change, they go with a box of documents, and then next one bring in the people, and there is the institutional memory and knowledge.
Well, I ask you this question because, you know, sometimes when you sit with people who leads an organization, they will always talk about themselves and the organization, but they don't really like indicate to the public, the staff, what the staff has done and their input. And that's why really, you know, because I know you do a lot of marketing in the sense of highlighting the ones who work alongside you.
Yeah, well, those are the people that do all the hard work. Yeah. Executives, we there, and I mean, yeah, I might spend a lot of time in the office, but generally, executives are volunteers.
Mm.
They have a life. And that's what creates issues in organizations, because decisions have to wait a week or a month till somebody who feel they're God's gift to the organization. That's not how it is at the TTOC. We have empowered, just like any organization, corporate, that is well-run.
Mm-hmm.
And let me say that was built up again. We have had presidents before me, Larry Romani, Douglas Camacho, Alexander B. Chapman, who have laid the foundation. So I am the 10th president. All I've done is walked on their shoulders.
Mm.
My task is to build on that and leave the TTOC strong for the next president to come in and do what he or she, hopefully it'll be or she, wants to do in terms of their vision, and they'll have the necessary support to be able to deliver effectively to the benefit of the athletes who form the center of it all, and the youth and young people of Trinidad and Tobago.
After TTOC, what next for Brian?
I mean, you know,
you have given your life to sports, actually.
Huh?
You have given your better part of your life to sports.
Yes, I started. I've been involved in sports since 8 years. I said, growing up single parent in Belmont. I mean, I had my little issues and dysfunctions as a youth, having a chip on my shoulder because I didn't have a father. And sports, if it wasn't for sport, I probably wouldn't be here talking. I would have gone the way of making some at-risk choices. I'm really grateful and thankful for sport for giving me the opportunity to serve and to help lay a path for young people. I've to be honest, I have a number of opportunities, you know, it, internationally to serve on different things. But I'm really looking forward to still young and active. there are things I want to be able to enjoy without people saying, well, what would the president could do that? Whether mm-hmm. it will be busting a line with friends. I mean, I love Carnival.
Yeah.
I love going to Rio Claro
mm-hmm.
by family, where from my father's side. I love doing a lot of things. I love doing a lot of things that I would love to do that I can't do because people
yeah.
say, but that's not the president of the Olympic Committee.
Yeah, but why should, I mean, I don't see, you know, if he's a president, you gotta live life too.
You know, I don't even, for one, I remember a time, right?
Mm-hmm.
I went to this Carnival line and I was having a good time, right? And I go like a bareback, right? Because it's Carnival,
yeah.
And you know people put up that picture and talk about what kind of example and thing, and people defend me and say, but the man is a trini, you know. So those are the type of trini. That is a hypocritical society, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not going to bring down the office or let down, but they always have this thing, but you have to set a good example, right? So as president of the Olympic Committee. I mean, I love Carnival. I had to be, you know, moderate. I mean, I like to play Juve. I had to play Juve with a suit and bow tie. I know, making no sense.
Mm.
So, you know, little things like that. I like to walk around the place. You're making me see all kind of thing on your program. I like to walk around the place with my little slippers and my three-quarter pants and a white vest. I just grew up in Belmont.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, now put your that thing, who you're playing.
Yeah.
Sometimes I do like to comb my hair on a weekend and relax. Oh, God. You know, so be laughed at.
So you go back to that normal life.
Yeah, and you know what's the funny part about it? You're not paid. You know, it's a volunteer thing.
Yeah.
And then you realize, wow.
That's commitment.
Huh?
That's commitment.
Yeah, boy, you realize, wow, boy. I thought, but people say it's the Olympic Committee, and that's why some people say, that's why we didn't want you. You know, you come with your Belmont behavior and your saga boy.
Mm-hmm.
A prominent columnist has been on my case, so I'm a saga boy.
Yeah.
Because of weird tie and thing. I don't know what he means by that. You know, if people examine,
the socio-cultural
dynamic of what is a saga boy. Some you can say it's racist, and elitist.
Why know about saga boy from our time, long time? Saga boy, your collar up in the air.
Correct.
And your coach hang out of your pocket.
Correct.
Yeah, son.
I know where the collar is. I know what it when I'm doing.
Yeah, saga boy, do wear bow tie and suit.
Saga boy is older fellas.
Collar up, yeah.
Dressing in the standard best.
And a little part on the side here.
Well, I'm really part gone, you know, because I could be here. I could go my hair, so I can wear my afro. You know, I always told myself, when I was growing up, because you had a 15 Italian, you know, which in that society was. So they tell me, well, you can't grow afro. So I always tell myself, you know, one of these days I will reach a point in my life where, you know, I mean, I ain't studying all year. I will grow my fro.
Yeah.
And I always used to envy them fellas and them wearing the bow tie and thing this Sunday.
Yeah.
I say I will do it. So I've been able to do that in my life. And, you know, but to answer your question, there's a part of me that want to reclaim my freedom to be me.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm looking for.
But you know, when you start to do that, they go still talk, okay? They go say, hey, and he was there.
That, well, you see, it's all right. Well, they could say he was. I'm not, right? I could play my Juve and diaper, wherever you wear Juve Nike and all them things, right? That's what Juve, you know?
Brad, it was a pleasure.
Yeah, man.
Right? And all the best in the remainder of your term and whatever you have plans for. I know you're going to enjoy yourself. And then you enjoy yourself after that.
Yeah. And if you're having fun and enjoying life, then
you must enjoy life.
Sense.
You must enjoy life. Because we want to say thanks to Brian and his team for coming down to the studio.
Declan. More important.
Big up to Declan.
Bring me here safely.
Yes, and you will take him back safely. And we want to tell you that I do enjoy sitting down and talk to Brian, you know, and I could imagine after you give up that post, how you will be when you're talking to him. That is another topic. If you miss any part of the program again, remember tomorrow is a repeat at 1 p.m. and Saturday at 2. Join us next week, same time, same channel, for another edition of Scoreboard on ACTN.